Long before the old Model T.
Hello and welcome to the IMW podcast. I'm your host, Greg McNaughton. This special video episode is brought to you in conjunction with At the Main Street Cinema and the Disney Park Hop and Party. On this episode, Electric Mike and I will be interviewing Rollie Crump, Disney Imagineer, Disney legend. Occasionally, you might see Mike's hands in the way of the screen or commenting to things that Rollie says. So sit back and enjoy this conversation with Rollie Crump. Rollie, before you started at Walt Disney Productions, what were you doing?
I was a head dipper in a ceramic factory.
A dipper?
Yeah,
in a ceramic factory.
I dip the pieces in clear glaze and put them on a tunnel that went all night long. They had a one of those tunnels that you never turned off, so the pieces could get glazed all night. So that was it. And before that, I was a board boy. I carried all the ceramics to the different people to work on, whether they were painting them or whether they were sculpting them or whatever. So I graduated from board boy to dipper. It was Christmas of 1952, I believe it was, that my mother invited me over for Christmas dinner, and she was with her cousin that she was living with, and then they had some other little ladies there, and one of the ladies had worked in animation at the studio. And so we were sitting there, and the subject came up that she'd worked in. I said, oh my God, I always wanted to work for Disney.
Sure.
And I said, but I don't know how to do it. And she said, well, I'll give you the name and the phone number of who to call. So I did. I called them, and they were really sweet. And they invited me to come in and meet with them, which I did. And then they said, we'd like to have you bring your portfolio in. So I did. I brought my portfolio in and showed it to them. And of course, basically, it was my high school portfolio and some work that I did. See, when I come home from work from the factory, I would do my own artwork on my own. I did a lot of pirates and stuff, and so I had that as well. So it was presented to the powers to be to take a look at, and they said, well, we'll call you. And I said, okay, fine. And so I went for about 2 or 3 weeks, and I was really excited, but then I got scared. And then they called me and said, come on in, we'd like to talk with you. So I went in and sat down with them, and they said, well, we're gonna hire you. And I said, oh my God, I almost died on the spot. And then they informed me what they'd pay me. And they said, you'll be starting at $30 a week. Well, I was making $75 a week in the cement.
As a dipper.
As a dipper. And now they want me to come to work at Disney for $30 a week. And I just was in a little bit of a shock because my wife was pregnant with our first daughter, and there was a freeway going through the house that we were living in. So I went home that night and I talked to my mom. And my mom said, honey, you've always wanted to work for Disney. She says, go for it. So I did. So I started working there, and had saved a little bit of money to help me support me. But then, the topper of all, I had a very close friend that built sewer manholes. So I got a job building sewer manholes on the weekend. So every Saturday and Sunday, I'd lower the bricks and mix the mud and lower it to him. So I was absolutely able to support myself. And the good news was I made more money in 2 days as a mixing mud than I did working for Disney. But the interesting thing about it was that most of us at that age time frame had second jobs. A lot of the guys worked in gas stations after work. And the whole thing was we were so thrilled to work for the Disney organization that we did whatever it took. I was the last in-betweener hired on Peter Pan. Well, what happened was after every feature, they'd have a huge layoff. And luckily, I never got laid off, but they broke me from being assistant to a breakdown and then down to an in-betweener, which was probably a $30 a week change in salary. Well, I had heard that milkmen made $100 a week. So I went out and tried to get a job as a milkman. And I applied at A-Door, and I said, I'd be interested in getting a job as a milkman. The guy said to me, he said, do you have any experience? And I said, no. And he said, well, we can't hire you. I said, how do you get experience as a milkman? And he couldn't answer that. I ended up taking a leave of absence. This was right after Lady and the Tramp, because I'd been broken down to practically nothing. And so I worked for an outside contractor, mixing mud, laying bricks and everything. And then that fall, the Mickey Mouse Club came out. And when the Mickey Mouse Club came out, then they wanted to beef up the animation department. Mm-hmm. So I was then rehired as an assistant animator immediately. So that meant I got about a $40 a week raise. And so I went back to Disney, and that's where I was. We were working on the Alice in Wonderland ride.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And so Claude Coates was sort of in charge of it. So he decided that because of my propellers, that he wanted one sequence or one scene or sequence in there to where all the flowers were propellers. So I started developing all these flowers that were propellers for the model. Walt always wanted a tea room at Disneyland, and he wanted one on Main Street. He wanted it for the older people that wanted to come in and have a cup of tea. Mm-hmm. So I was asked to start designing a tea room, which I did. I came up with all kinds of different clocks that would be in the tea room. And while I was in the middle of that was when they decided they were going to redo Adventureland. And they wanted to, then they decided they'd put a little restaurant in there. Okay. And then they decided that the tea room would go into this little restaurant. And so then it was decided that we'd get John Hinch to do a rendering of what a little tiki restaurant might look like as far as being a tea room as well. So John did a beautiful rendering of a Polynesian little restaurant, and he had birds in cages in there, and Walt came in and looked at it, and he took one look at the rendering that John had done and said, John, you got birds in those cages there. And John says, yes. And he says, well, you can't have birds in there. And John says, why not? He said, because they'll poop in the food. And that's exactly what he said. And John says, no, Walt, they're stuffed birds. And Walt said, no, John, Disney doesn't stuff birds. And then John said, well, no, they're not stuffed birds. And he said, well, they're little mechanical birds. And Walt said, oh, little mechanical birds. And so he said, yes. And then there was about six of us in the meeting, and somebody else said, yeah, well, maybe one of the birds would whistle to another bird, and the other bird might whistle back, and then maybe we'll get the birds to chirp to each other. So by the time we got finished with it, all of a sudden we'd gotten to where birds were kind of in charge of what was going on in there. So we were all asked to go on back and do some different ideas. I was asked to design some birds, and there was a lot of us working on it. There was guys in the model shop were working on it. And the next meeting we had developed the fact that this was going to be a bird show. And so then Walt said to me, he says, Rollie, he says, I know you like built mobiles. He said, I want a mobile coming out of the ceiling with 100 birds on it. And I said, okay. I said, okay to whatever he asked. Well, meanwhile, he had told the machine shop to design a chandelier that would hold 100 birds. Well, they came back and said, we can't put 100 birds on that. The unit would be too big, because that's when we were using air. They were not electric, they was all air. And to have all those air lines go down, it wasn't, you couldn't handle it. Yeah. Couldn't handle it, 100 birds. So they came back with 30 birds. And so the next thing I know, Walt said, okay, Rollie, I want you to go up there and sculpt that bird mobile that they just, well, what happened was they just built this thing that came down that where the birds were gonna be, and it was just a bunch of iron. And so it was my responsibility to take a funny little sketch Mark Davis did, and make it like a piece of driftwood. So I actually was put on a Raymond lift and taken up and put the clay on there and actually sculpt that whole thing from a Raymond lift, which was kind of cute, because the only time they'd let me down was if I had to go to the bathroom or they'd bring me down for lunch. So I lived aboard that for about 2 weeks up on that Raymond lift, but actually sculpted that whole birdmobile. Meanwhile, Walt decided that he wanted me to design some tikis that would go out into the pre-show area. He said, because when people are standing in line to have lunch or dinner, he said, you've got to entertain them. So I designed, went to John Hinch, and he said, well, you get a book on the islands of the Pacific and learn about the gods and their spirits, which I did. And so I started developing little pen and ink drawings of all the different tikis. And they actually were based on something. One, Rongo, but Pele was a god of fire and volcanoes. And Rongo was the god of agriculture. And he also was a god of kite flying. And so I got into all these great little stories about these gods. And I did all these sketches to show Walt. And one of them was not a real god. All the other ones had a story behind them. One of them was just a guy peeing into a piece of, spitting water into a bamboo chute that would dump and come back. And so Walt looked at all of them and said, and that when it came back, it would hit a little post and go thump. And Walt said, what's that the god of? Well, I panicked because I didn't know. So John Hinch stepped up and said, well, that's a god of Tampa cloth beating. And he said it kind of quick, Tampa cloth beating. So Walt misunderstood him and he said, John, what kind of a clock? And he says, it's a god that tells the time. And so these are what we call happy accidents. So all that little miscommunication between John and Walt presented that. So when the meeting was over, John says, you better go find out who the hell the god is that tells the time. And I did. I looked him up and it was Maui. So I developed Maui. So that's how they all got developed. And then I ended up sculpting them. Now, this is something that nobody ever does anymore, is take your sketch, get it bought off. It doesn't go to an engineer. It goes to you who sculpts it. And I had never sculpted before in my life. I went to who's in charge of Blaine Gibson, that was in charge of sculpting. We only had one sculptor. And I said, Walt bought off on these. I said, Blaine, we got to get them sculpted. He says, Rollie, I don't have time to sculpt them. And I said, well, who's going to do it? He says, you are. And I says, I am. He says, yeah, you're going to sculpt them. So he taught me how to make armatures, and I sculpted them all. And the first one I did, because the office was so cold that I couldn't get the clay to get soft, so I took the armature and the clay out into the parking lot where the sun was out, and I got the clay soft so I could apply it to the armature. And so Maui was built, was designed and sculpted in the parking lot. And so you think about all the technology that, you know, sculptors have, the north light in a big, beautiful studio. No, we did it in the parking lot. And the original one that I did, and I don't know, this will be all right because you can always edit it out if you want.
We'll fix it in post.
Yeah, but the original one I did was the original sculpture, that piece of bamboo really was his weenie. And when it went back and hit something, in fact, if you look, what it hits on the head is another little sculptor, tiki, and it's his wife. So it goes back and hits her on the head.
My name is Maui. Natives call me the Mighty One.
Well, you did whatever was necessary to have it happen. Then they made fiberglass mold, pieces of them, and brought back, and I painted them. So I not only came up with the idea, I also sculpted the damn little guys. I painted them, and I actually installed them. I was down there with a wrench, screwing them down.
You did it.
But that was the way we all worked it. I wasn't the only one that worked that way. We all worked that way there at WED. The bottom line was we built a soundstage over at the studio for 20,000 leagues. So because of that hole in the floor, we were able to put the tiki room there, because that shaft that comes out in the center that releases the water could go down into the lower part of that. That's the only way. So we did a full-scale mock-up of the tiki room and the show. And we ran it, and Walt just loved it. And basically, Walt said, you know what? He said, this is not going to be a restaurant. We'd already bought the furniture, the tables, the chairs, and everything for the restaurant. He said, because the public will never leave. So he says, we're going to make it a show. And so he held off on it. And we said, we'll open it next year. And everybody was having a fit because they want to get income back from it, because you had to pay a dollar to see it the first, when they first opened it up. So anyway, that's how what happened. And it became an animated, first animatronic show that was ever designed and built. And it started with just a little idea of a tea restaurant on Main Street. And by the way, everybody sat in the chairs that were bought for the restaurant until recently. They finally took the chairs out and made it bench seating for more capacity. But the tables never got put over into the Tahitian Terrace, so they didn't lose out on that.
So, Wally, we know you were working on the Tower of the Four Winds, but how did you get over on the Small World project?
Well, I'd already been assigned to design the Tower of the Four Winds as a marquee in front of Small World. What happened was Walt came in and called a meeting one day, an impromptu meeting. We just finished doing Mr. Lincoln and also Carousel of Progress. And so we had already done, three different pavilions for the World's Fair. And he says, there's a piece of real estate left and we can have it if we want it. And he says, I've got an idea for a little boat ride for children around the world. And we all looked at him like he was kind of nuts. We were thinking that he was thinking of something like the little boat ride in Disneyland, Storybook Land. Mm-hmm. And we thought, why would you put a Storybook Land in the World's Fair? Well, not realizing what he really had in mind, he said, I want this to be about children from around the world. So we all sat there and said, okay, well, Mark Davis was given the job to come up with the first sketch of what the interior of Small World might look like. And so the following week when Walt came, Mark gave him his sketch and Walt took one look at it and said, what's Mary Blair doing? Meaning that it didn't have the charm that he wanted. And instead of saying to Mark, I don't really care for this, he just said, no, what's Mary Blair doing? So Dick Irvine called Mary because, that was her style.
Yes.
Mary had this childlike style and always had it all of her life. So they flew her out and we all met her. And they said, we want to do this ride around the world for children and we want to get a feel of what you think the styling might look like. So she really styled the entire ride. So she would send her sketches out and then we would build models from her sketches of what the buildings would look like. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, Mark and Alice decided to do the little musicians and the dancers, and then I was asked to do the toys. So I not only designed the toys, we built the toys. I had 30 people working for me and we were building them out of styrofoam and paper mache. So it was a process of designing the Tower of the Four Winds and also building all the toys. And there's kind of a cute story, but we won't get into there on that one. So then the next thing I know is we're subcontracting all the sets to Garage Studios and send the models over to Garage Studios. And Garage Studios, there was never any working drawings done on the models for the sets. And so what happened was Garage would do shop drawings. They would take a model, measure it, and then they do a shop drawing. So all of the sets were designed off and built off of shop drawings. And then Walt wanted to see all of them set up before they went to New York. Now we did all of this in 9 months, which is absolutely incredible. Mm-hmm. So we had all the sets brought over, put in one of the sound stages, and then we lit them. And we'd push Walt through in a boat that was on wheels at the right speed of the boat if it was in the trough so he could look at the sets. And so once that section was, he would give us a buy-off on it, then it would be shipped to New York and then we'd bring the next section over. So we did that about 6 times with him and took him through it. And so it was completely approved by Walt and set up for Walt before it went to the World's Fair, and then it was set up. So I ended up being sort of in charge of getting all of it shipped over, getting it shipped back, and getting it all done, and learning how Garage Studios was so important to us. And there's kind of an interesting story about that. Later on, when they did Epcot, management felt that if Disney didn't build all the sets and all the stuff, then it wouldn't be Disney. So that's when they created Big Tahunga, to where they built all the sets and stuff. And I felt like saying, wait a minute, Garage Studios did it, and they did it on a very reasonable basis. That whole thing, I forget what they call it, but it became extremely expensive, and finally they had to kill it because it cost so much money. So the cost of what we did for, Epcot was ridiculous. And if we'd subcontracted out, but we didn't have Dick Irvine to do that, and John Hinch knew how, but he wouldn't do it. So he didn't want the responsibility of it. So that was just another one of the little tricks of the trade that we had when Walt was with us to subcontract out. Finally, they came to me and they said, Rollie, you know, we got to get the facade designed. Meanwhile, Mary had been asked to design the facade.
Uh-huh.
And Mary didn't know anything about three-dimensional. She was absolutely incredible flat, but when it came to three-dimensional, so she decided that she was going to design the facade. In fact, it's on that TV show to where Walt interviews her, and she's in there making little blocks and stuff, mm-hmm. and gluing him up and everything. And she thought she was going to think like a child and design this facade. Well, it really turned out to be a piece of crap. It really was. And not only that, she went into the interior of the ride and started putting carpet on all the sets. And she was just going nuts because this was the first chance she had of controlling the models. See, before they didn't let her control the models, the model shop took over. Mm-hmm. So she started doing all this weird stuff. And I remember the meeting with Walt and her, and Walt took one look at it and said, you know, Mary, I don't think this is the way we're going to do it. I think right. we're going to take another way. Well, poor little thing got upset, went down, had six martinis, and caught a plane and went home. So anyway, that's how that all happened. Really, true story. And she went home. And then all of a sudden, the next thing I know, Dick Irvine calls me and he said, well, Mary's not here to design the facade. He says, I want to put you in charge of the facade. And I said, okay, Dick, but I'm not answering to anybody but Walt. He says, no problem, because they were running out of time at that time frame. So I got Fred Jerger, and I had been studying Mary's work the whole time, and I had actually built what I considered, and in fact, it's in my room, what I considered the facade should look like out of wood. I mm-hmm. did that on my own. Mm-hmm. And I showed it to Mary, and she says, oh, that's great. I'll put it in with my stuff. And I thought, oh, no. So anyway, Fred and I sat down for 1 week and did it all in black and white cardboard, the whole facade, uh-huh. including the clock and everything. And when we got finished with that, we had Walt come over. And Walt took one look at it and said, yeah, this is great, go for it. And during that time frame, we had little trees and flowers and bushes that we had made, and we had them on a board, and we didn't know where to put the board, so we put it up on top of the building that was representing Small World Ride. And when Walt came, he came a little early, and he saw all these little trees and bushes up at the top, and he thought we put them up there on purpose. We said, no, it's just easier to reach up and bring them down and set them. He said, I don't care. He said, I think it's a good idea. So when we opened the Small World there, we had trees all over the roof. I don't think the trees are still there anymore. I think they just, you know, maintenance probably couldn't afford uh-huh. it after a while. But he said, you know, people won't know there's a building back there with all those trees up there. So that was the story of the trees. And then the next thing was for me to turn the cardboard into wood. Uh-huh. So I got Jack Fergus, the best model builder in the model shop, to build them all out of wood. And so he built this beautiful half-inch scale model all out of wood. I added propellers to it. I added doilies to it. So I kind of decorated it. And then it came time for Walt to buy off on it. And Dick Irvine wouldn't come out, or none of his guys. Walt came out all by himself. Wow. Dick sent him out. I sent him out all by himself because he didn't want to be there if Walt didn't like it. And Walt looked at it and studied it for, I don't know, maybe 5 or 10 minutes. And he turned to me and he said, do you have any excuses today, Rollie? And I said, no, sir, I don't. He says, well, then build it. And that was it. And that's what it was like for me to work with the old man. First of all, when I was designing the facade, I went uh-huh. to Disneyland. I said, what should I build the facade out of? And they said, fiberglass. They right. said, that's the only thing that's going to last. And they said, Rollie, don't use any color, because we'll have to repaint it every year because the sun will burn it out. And he said, that'll raise our maintenance cost tremendously. So I said, okay. Well, I remember in Storybook Land, there was a little castle with a gold roof on one of the buildings. And I said, Jesus, what paint do you use to keep it that gold? They said, that's not paint, that's gold leaf. I said, what's gold leaf? They showed me what gold leaf was. So then I decided to use the gold leaf on the facade in different locations, on the propellers and everything. And so then I thought, well, let's use gold as the accent. So it'll stay white and the gold, and that's why I used the gold doilies and everything. Well, the bottom line is we used up all the gold leaf in the United States when we built that.
In the United States?
In the United States. We used up all gold leaf. We had to go to Germany and get gold leaf. So another little...
That's a lot of gold leaf.
That's, well, you bet your sweet it is.
And it's still there?
No, what happened was, yes, it is. No, it is still there, except that the gold leaf that we got from Germany went bad on us. And so we had to reap. It wasn't really gold leaf that they sold us. Anyway, that's the facade. For some reason, Walt had in the back of his mind about doing a haunted mansion when he opened Disneyland, and he'd had a lot of the other animators come up with concept sketches for it back in the 50s, long before I got involved. And then I guess Yale Gracie was then invited to work at WED, and Yale was a background painter, but Yale was kind of a little tinker toy. He was kind of like Geppetto, and he did all kinds of crazy little things, and so they hired him, and then they put he and I together, and Walt said, why don't you guys work on concepts for the Haunted Mansion?
Kind of like
had this big room upstairs, and all we did was read ghost stories and go to the movies to see ghost movies and just kind of hang out and come up with different ideas. And it was a lot of fun. We really did. We bought all kinds of masks and stuff. Now, there's another cute little story coming up here now.
Okay,
are you ready for this? We had all these skeletons and we had ugly heads, and we'd build a monster that you could shoot with an infrared gun, and the monster would blow up and its head would come off and swing around the room because it was attached to the ceiling with a little cord. Mm-hmm. So we got a call from personnel, and they said, the janitors would appreciate it if you leave the lights on when you go home at night, because walking in there was a little bit spooky. So Yale and I said, sure. So being that we grew up in animation, which was constant, you know, gags on each other, we rigged the room. And what we did was we had an infrared beam across the center of the room. We left a little light on. I'd had a ghost made that was a big shimmering ghost made out of China silk with a squirrel cage fan underneath it. And we had the monster, and then we had a bunch of heads that were all done in black light paint. And so what happened was, if you broke the beam, the little light that was on would go off, the monster would blow up, the ghost that would come up and shimmer would come up and do that, the lights would come on all the ugly heads. So we went home. And when we came back the next day, sure enough, the little ghost was still shaking all night long. The monster had blown up and his head was hanging from the ceiling. And we got a call from personnel.
Of course you did.
And said, they're never coming back. Well, we went back into the room, and sure enough, there was a broom laying right in the middle of the floor. So we had to clean up our room from after that. But that was one of the best. When we play gags on each other, I think that was the best gag that we ever played. And it's well known. We built models for Walt to come take a look at. And one of the models was built on museum. I mean, Pepper's Ghost.
Oh, yes.
And so what happened was Yale had this book, not this particular one, but he had this one that has in it Pepper's Ghost, which is an illusion where you use a big piece of glass and you reflect a ghost on it. He had a sword fight with a ghost on stage with that. And this was he did this in 1860. So Pepper's Ghost goes back to 1860, and the illusion of how to build a Pepper's Ghost is in here. So we started developing a lot of the ideas that would be Pepper's Ghost ideas, and then showing Walt little models with reflection of it, which he loved, absolutely loved. Well, basically, I didn't like the direction the mansion was going. Uh-huh. I felt that there was no imagination in it. There was nothing in there that was different. And so I started thinking about what would be different. And then I started thinking of movies. And there was a Jacques Cousteau, French director, that did Beauty and the Beast back in the 40s. And the Beast lived in a castle. And in the castle, there were human arms on the walls that had the torches that would lead the monster down the hallway. Mm-hmm. There was a hand holding up from a table with a bowl of grapes and would offer them to the monster. And also there were human heads in the fireplace with steam coming out of them. And I thought, you know, that's the kind of stuff we got to get in here. Yeah. There was Fellini's Juliet of the Spirits was a movie. So those two movies got my imagination going about starting to create things that are very unusual. They could be scary or not scary, but at the same time, they were unusual. So I started doing all these sketches. The first sketch I did was a candle man, which was a figure standing, holding his arms up, and his fingers were on fire, and he was actually dripping. He was like a candle. And so that was my first one. And then I started developing more and more. And the guys that were the other art directors and designers kept saying, well, you know, that stuff's pretty weird, Rollie. We're not sure whether Walt would like that. And of course, Dick Irvine, our leader there at WED, wasn't happy about it at all. But Jack Fergus, who was a close friend of mine, Big Jack, said, Rollie, I'm not doing anything. Can I build a model on what you're drawing? I said, yeah. So he built models of all these little things that I was coming up with. So we had a pretty good sized little table of stuff, including the artwork. And so there was finally going to be a presentation to Walt about the Haunted Mansion. Uh-huh. And Claude had his sketches, Mark Davis had his, the architect had his layout. And then they stuck me over in a corner behind where Walt was going to sit. And so we had about a 3-hour session with Walt on it. And then finally, Walt said to Dick Irvine, is that it? And of course, he had not included me. And he said, yeah, that's it. And he said, well, what's this stuff in the corner? Uh-oh. And Dick Irvine said, well, that's something that Rollie did. And he says, well, what is it that Rollie did? He says, we don't know. Why don't you ask him? So Walt turned to me and says, Rollie, what have you got here? So I got, Walt and I both rolled our chairs over to the little table, and I started telling him everything that I had said earlier, that there was nothing strange about the museum. I mean, about the Haunted Mansion. We needed to inject some strangeness. So he and I sat there and talked for quite a while, and he said, God, really, I don't know how we can use it. Do you know? And I said, no. And he said, but it's really weird. And I says, yes, I know what's weird. But you still don't know how you're going to use it? No, sir, I don't. So after about two or three things about how you're going to use it, Walt stood up and said, I'm going to go home. I'm going home now, so I'm going to go. And so he got up and left the room, and everybody was just thrilled that he left. And they all came to me and said, we told you that Walt wouldn't like that. And I said, I know, but I had a lot of fun doing it anyway. So then what happened, I came to work the next morning at 7 o'clock, and Walt's sitting in my chair. He still has the same clothes on that he wore the day before. And the first thing he said to me is, you son of a bitch. And I said, whoa. And he said, I didn't get an ounce of sleep last night because of all that strange stuff you showed me yesterday. And I said, oh God, I'm sorry. And he says, no, don't be sorry. He says, I know how we're going to use it. And I says, you do? And he says, yeah. We're going to build a museum, and it's going to be called the Museum of the Weird. And Rollie, you can design whatever you want and put it in the museum. So when people exit from the Haunted Mansion, they can exit through the museum. That was going to be an exit room. So I said, oh, that's good. Meanwhile, Dick Irvine finally shows up with two cups of coffee trying to find Walt, because he knew that Walt's car was in the garage before he got there. So he gave Walt his cup of coffee. And Walt said, get the rest of the guys, Dick. So he did. He went and got all the other guys that were there the day before and took a half hour and explained the entire Museum of the Weird to him. And he said, now I'm going to go home and go to bed, because he hadn't had any sleep that night. And so as he left, they all came up to him and said, you know, Rollie, we really knew you had something there. And at that point in time was when I really knew what the rest of the guys were really like. The bottom line was Walt. Walt said, we want a scary haunted mansion. Mm-hmm. He says, everybody loves to be scared. And so his bottom line wanted a scary one. And of course, what's his name? Said later on, he says, we don't want to scare the public. And that was Dick Irvine. He didn't want it scary at all. And of course, by that time, it was too late on what was going on. Mm-hmm. But the original Haunted Mansion was designed as a walkthrough, and Walt wanted it that way. And we'd gone up to the Seattle World's Fair, and we'd seen how an elevator that could hold 100 people go up into the ceiling and they'd disappear. So we decided to do the same thing. We'd take the elevator down so that people could get out from underneath the railroad tracks, get over that way. And so we started developing as a scary. Now, Mark's sketches in the elevator room Actually, I did the original ones, but Mark came in one day and said mine weren't any good and he was going to redesign them, which he did. I didn't care. I didn't get locked up on whoever I was and what I was doing. So he developed those and they were whimsical, which was great. You know, he probably did a much better job than I would have done. But then what happened is Yale and I had come up with the idea of a ghost host. And what happened is the first room that you went into was a library. Mm-hmm. And in there was all these pieces of sculpture and the room came to life. And there was 100 of you standing in there. And then all of a sudden, the ones with the steam coming out of their mouths over the fireplace and some of the other statues, and we had the projected face on the ball in there. And so we had the room come to life and talked to, and they were talking back and forth like there was no one in the room. Mm-hmm. It was like spirits in a room that was a library talking to each other. So we developed that room, and then the idea being that each room would be 3 minutes long. And then you would go to the next room. And then we introduced a ghost host. And via Pepper's ghost, we made it actually appear out of nothing. And he introduced himself and said, come with me. And so you followed the voice from the ghost host to the next room. And in this room, it was all like a little theater, all tiers. And you stood in there looking down below. And down below was an old sea captain that had been drowned at sea. And so he had his cap on, and he had his slicker, and he was covered with seaweed and everything. And the ghost host would say, now this is where the captain lived. Now, if you look closely, you'll see that he comes and visits now and then. So using the Pepper's ghost, we slowly brought him on. And when he was off stage, we actually had a shower on him. So when he came on, there was water dripping off of him, going all over the floor and everything, and being covered with seaweed. And they said, and you know, he did murder his wife, and she's in the fireplace. And then all of a sudden, you see this image appear in the fireplace, and he's standing there. And when he appeared very slowly. Very slowly. I mean, he came on slow, and then all of a sudden she appears, and she comes out of the fireplace screaming, and she comes out to attack him, and then they both disappear. And the sad thing about it is that would have been the best goddamn illusion that was ever designed and built, yeah. Except that when you're in a moving vehicle, you can't do it. Yeah. Everything has to be on a cycle. You can't take that 3 minute time frame and develop a real Pepper's ghost. And we did. We did it, and we showed it to Walt. That we built it on the sound stage, and he just loved it, and it was great. But then after Walt passed away, operations was scared to death to have people walking loose in there because they'd think that the kids would vandalize it, you know. So there was a little concern there. That's why they went to an omnimover. But we lost the best illusion that ever could have been, because no way would you have been able to figure that one out. You know, see, Mark and Claude were given to do the Haunted Mansion, and then they sent me to exile to Disneyland as supervising art director of maintenance to get me out of the building. That was Dick Irvine's idea. He didn't know what to do with me, and he didn't want to put me on the Haunted Mansion, because without Walt I wouldn't have any power, obviously. And so he shipped me to Disney. I said, I'm going to make you art director for Disneyland, and you go down there and take care, because there was an Iron Curtain between WED and Disneyland. Disneyland could not do anything. They couldn't change the color of anything or the change of the wallpaper unless somebody from WED was in charge. So that was Rollie. They sent Rollie down there. I'm the father of that, because once I got down there, I got Kimmy Irvine to start working with me. I got another fellow that was in special effects. And then I got Orlando to get us a trailer. And so but we didn't call SQS at that time. It was just a bunch of little guys in a trailer. But I'm absolutely the father. I'm very proud of that, being the father. Yeah. Dick Irvine said, Rollie, we want to make you an art director. So we want you to redesign redesign the bazaar. Uh-huh. So I got down there. I didn't know what the hell I was going to do. And there was no drawings on it. There was nothing. And luckily, Jack Olson, who was the head of merchandise at Disneyland at that time, I worked with. And Jack says, well, Rollie, what we can do is we'll make a real bazaar out of it. We'll go to the boneyard and get stuff out of the boneyard. Mm-hmm. I didn't even know there was a boneyard. So I went down to the boneyard, and there were old ticket booths. So we took three of the old ticket booths out. And what happened was they had hired Garage Studios. They used to subcontract out a lot of the stuff. A lot of people don't know that all the sets in Small World were built by Garage Studios. They weren't built by Disney at all. That's another story. Mm. Oh, yeah. And that's the one thing that Dick was good at. I've got to give Dick credit, and that's why Walt hired him. He knew how to get the job done. And he knew how to do, keep an eye on it as far as the budgets go. So the first thing I knew was that I was going to have three painters and three carpenters work with me in a soundstage that we rented, Allied Soundstage, and build the bazaar. And so I started picking up all these pieces, the ticket booths, and sending them up there and getting them sanded down. And then, you know, I actually glued the tile on one of them. There's mosaic tile all over the roof of one of them. And I did all that while I was waiting. And I did some sketches and stuff of some of the things to be built. And so I would draw a sketch up, and I'd give it to a carpenter, and I'd say, build this. And I remember there was one carpenter, he'd say, okay, he says, but what's the scale? And I said, scale? I didn't even know what a scale ruler was. And so he had to teach me what a scale ruler was. Uh-huh. So the sketches that I did, I knew they were 6 or 8 feet tall. So I made my own scale. And I think it was a foot equals an inch and a quarter or something. And so I built a little cardboard scale ruler for me, and I built one for him while I was doing these sketches. And it was kind of cute because after we finished it, he came up to me and says, I want to keep this ruler that you gave me because you never can tell, Rollie, we might work together again sometime. So, and I had to go back to Wynn and find out what the hell a scale ruler was. But anyway, the other cute little behind the scenes story was Dick Irvine didn't believe I'd get it done on time. So he lied to me about the opening date. And I found out about it because it was actually a week after he told me. And every Friday I'd have to go back to his office and tell him how the bazaar was coming. I only had 6 weeks, design it, build it, and install it. Yeah. So I worked 8 days a week, every week. I mean, it was that time frame. And so I remember that because I found out about it, I never told Dick that I knew that he'd lied to me about the date. So the Friday that I went back to tell him, I said, okay, tomorrow, because we were supposed to open it up in Disneyland to the public the following Wednesday. Mm-hmm. That Friday night, I told him, I said, well, tomorrow we're shipping all the stuff for the bazaar to the Disneyland. And he didn't know what to do. He couldn't tell me, wait, it's too early. So what he did was he got on the phone with Joe Fowler. And I'm sitting there, and he told Joe, he says, you know, we're shipping the bazaar tomorrow. And Joe Fowler probably yelled at him on the phone and says, Dick, we don't need it until the following week. And Dick says, no, this is where Wed had the power. So what happened was they had the guys come in. The floor wasn't even in yet.
Yeah.
So they had the guys come in and work the whole weekend and all night long to get the floor in so when my stuff got there. And so I never let Dick know that I'd made the date. But what happened was he changed the date because he said there was an operational change. So I had the bazaar up and running on the day that I was promised to do it. And then of course he said, well, operations had some problems, and we had to do that. But that, you know, that's the thing that you learn. When you've been given an assignment and you date to do it, by you bust your ass. Because I didn't even go home on the weekends hardly for 6 weeks. I never saw my family because I was so dedicated to get this job done. So that was one of the stories of the bazaar. They tore it out of there before I retired and redid it for no reason, you know, just to give somebody something to do. Because the bazaar I had still had all those pieces in it that belonged to the antiques of Disneyland. It'd been a great, if they kept it, it'd be a great place to go. And you say, yeah, that used to be a ticket booth. And the columns that we had in there had been in the chicken plantation. So the whole thing was built off of bits and pieces that had history. But you know, that's, people don't think about the importance of that.
I understand your son, Chris Crump, is working at Walt Disney Imagineering, carrying on the Crump legacy as an Imagineer.
Yes, he is.
What project has he been working on recently?
Well, basically, he's a project manager and also sort of a semi-art director, but The Little Mermaid was one of the big things that he did, and that was just recently. So he's been in charge of the manufacturing, the building of that, and also the help of the special effects and the design. So he's very proud of that. You'll have to remember that when I was working at WED, I used to take him to, we had tickets to Dodgers games, you know, and so I used to take him to Dodger games all the time. And so my wife would bring him in and drop him off when he was a little guy. And then he and I would go to the ball game and then I'd go home. So he got to wander around in the model shop. So he got to know, you know, John Hanch, he got to know Claude Coates, he got to know Harriet Burns, he got to know Lee Toombs, he got to know everybody that worked at WED way back then. So he almost was family with the family that was there. And he remembers that.
If you had to pick one project that never got developed or fully realized that you saw in your time at Imagineering, what would that be?
Yeah, the museum of the weird.
Museum would be the one.
Yeah, they, a bunch of WED kids tried to design one and talk, and they invited me to come in and take a look at it. It was just a piece of crap.
Yeah.
And I didn't want any part of it. I thought, if you're gonna, see, I learned that when you're doing something that's themed, you trace the original theming of it. And when I did the Toad ride for Florida, I traced all the backgrounds from Toad. I traced everything to make sure that it was what it was.
Yes.
You don't interpret. You don't when you're picking something that's an established theme.
Right.
And so that's the way I felt about it.
Well, Rollie, one of my favorite restaurants in Huntington Beach has a whole bunch of paintings on the wall, and I looked closely one day, and your name's in the lower right corner. And then I found an article they had taped in the window saying "Small World Disney Small World Designer designs the interior for local restaurant." So can you tell us the story behind this?
There was a little Chinese designer, and she worked for me at WED when I was there at the end. And Judy Shin was her name, and she was absolutely an incredible designer. And I'd give her a project to do, and she would go through it, and just, it would be perfect, absolutely perfect. She really understood the old philosophy of how to design. So what happened was she got let go, which was stupid. She called me one day and she said, you know, I've got a project. She says that there's a lady that runs a Chinese restaurant, and this was in LA, this was in Norwalk. And they want me to design this one room. And she said, Rollie, I don't know what to do. Would you help me? And I said, sure. I said, I'll come down, go to the restaurant, have dinner and meet with them and take a look. And what it was they had a big Chinese restaurant, but then they had an annex. And in the annex were little games. It was a game room. Mm-hmm. And they got so busy that they wanted to turn that annex into another dining room. So, they said, Judy, would you do it? So she and I sat down and I told her, I said, honey, why don't you make it like a patio? Put fake brick on the floor, put lattice work up, and then we'll sponge the walls behind the lattice work to look like they're hedges, and then we'll put umbrellas in there and a table. So it looks like a little patio. She says, okay, great. So when it came time to do the, I told her, I said, I'll help you sponge the walls so that it looks like it's been foliage. So when the time came, she called me, she says, would you come show us how to sponge the walls? Well, I used to sponge the backgrounds on my paintings, but I never sponged walls. I've actually got photos of me sponging those goddamn walls. So I went down and I sponged the walls and had dinner with the owner and her husband. And when we got finished, we were sitting in the dining room looking in there, and the owner says, God, I really like those sponged walls. She says, let's not put any lattice work up. And I said, okay, fine. So anyway, I told Judy, I said, why don't you go see if you can't get some posters with parrots on it, or, you know, birds from, you know, the jungle or whatever. She called me back a week later. She says, Rollie, I can't find anything. So I went and had dinner with her and the owners again, and I thought, well, you know, I was still working at WED at the time. I hadn't retired. I said, maybe I'll do some paintings for you of some birds or something. So I went home in my apartment and I started painting up these little wild animals, sponging the backgrounds and everything. And so I did a whole series of the paintings, and then I took them down and I gave them to them, gave them to the owners. And they said, well, how much do we owe you for that? And I said, if I charge you what I normally would charge, I said, you couldn't afford me. I said, so I'm going to give them to you. So I gave them the paintings. Oh, God, they were thrilled. And I said, but the one thing I do want, I want a free dinner and all the beer I can drink whenever I want it. They said, no big, no deal. So I used to go down there about once a month and have a nice Chinese dinner and a couple of beers. Well, then they decided to close up that one and open up another one in a different location. So they did that, but they didn't take the paintings. They left the paintings there with that. So she said, would you do some more paintings for me? And I said, sure. So I gave her a budget as an art director and an artist, and I did the paintings and I decorated and called out for all the tables and chairs and the color of the restaurant. So I did the whole interior decor and everything was fine. You know, that was good. And I never did go there for any meals or anything because it was kind of tucked away. And meanwhile, she called me about a year later and she says, well, I'm opening up a new one in Huntington Beach. And she says, I really need to hire you again to do all of this. And so at that time I said, sure. And I gave her a very reasonable rate. I think I charged her $2,000 or $3,000 to do the whole interior design, all the painting, including the paintings. And more people, a young couple have had dinner there and found us because of that and bought one of my paintings.
Roland Fargo Crump?
Junior.
Junior, thank you for sitting down with Mike and I and indulging us this afternoon and answering all these questions. I know our audience will surely enjoy this as we have. And thank you very much.
So, as long as you're all standing,
we have a wonderful magic trick for you.
Yeah, a wunderbar trick. Everybody, face the door. And the trick is, we're gonna make you all disappear.